you have your Bibles, turn with us to the book of 2 Timothy, chapter number 3. 2 Timothy, chapter number 3. We'll have one verse read to you this morning, chapter number 3, and verse number 16. Stand with us, if you will, while we read, while you're turning there. Eli, come on up here, buddy. Timothy chapter number 3 and verse number 16.
All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine and reproof, for correction and instruction and in righteousness.
Thank you, sir. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the word of God this morning. Thank you, God, for your goodness and your grace. Lord, as we enter this year, God, this new year, God, which is, Father, another day closer, another year closer to the coming of the Lord, I pray, God, that this word of God that we have, Lord, would become more important to us every day of our lives. And Father, we need your help this morning as we try to rightly divide the word of truth. And Lord, I pray, God, that we'd handle the word, God, with great power and great conviction and, Lord, great honor today and great respect. Because truly, Lord, this is your word that we have. I pray, God, you bless the message. Again, help us, strengthen us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Brother Eli, thank you so much for reading the scripture for us today. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. For what? For doctrine? For reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Now, Paul writes this to Timothy after that he has given him a list beginning with verse number 1. Now, if you're here Wednesday night, you heard some of the same things you're going to be hearing this morning, but it won't hurt you, amen, it won't hurt you a bit. And so I want to begin back with verse number 1 and just go through a few things, and if we can this morning, by the help of God, we want to preach to you a message called The Bible in Perilous Times. The Bible in Perilous Times in which we're living. And as we go into the Lord laid it on my heart to make most assuredly to the church this year that we hold a standard for the church and for our lives directed by the Word of God. Now, you know, most organizations have a handbook. In years past, there was a company that, you know, that needed a handbook. And I was privileged to be able to write their departmental handbook. Because they needed some guidelines on how to operate their departments. And so I was privileged to write a departmental handbook for that company. And as you know, as I wrote that, I began to think, how could God's people get along without a handbook? And the Lord said, you've got a handbook, and that is the Word of God. And so we are living in days when we must be guided by our handbook, which is the Word of God. It tells us everything we need to know about being a Christian. Everything we know about living godly in Christ Jesus, it tells us everything we know about, that we need to know about living in perilous times. Now, what are the perilous times that we're living in? I am not going to get anywhere near where I thought I'd go this morning, but that's all right. What are the perilous times that we're living in? This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. Verse number 1. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. What is the last days? Now the last days, and this may, after studying, and you know, I was perplexed by that for some time, not really because I didn't understand it, but because I couldn't capture the meaning of the last days. Now we have humanity, the world, has been living in the last days since the gospel began. That's the easiest way I know to explain to you. Since the gospel began, we have been living in the last days. Since Christ died and the gospel began, that's when the gospel was completed, when Christ arose, mankind has been living in the last days of time. Now, but preacher, could Jesus have come back? He could have come back right after he left if he'd wanted to and been right about it and nothing have to change. But we as believers in this year of 2017 are living in the last of the last days. Now, I wake up in the morning. Lord, help me. I wake up in the morning. What's it going to be, the 18th? Is that right? 16th. Oh, my. But if I wake up in the morning on the 16th, about 7 hours after it started, I'm living, still living in the 17th, ain't I? The day of the 17th. And if I go to bed before midnight, which I try to, all that day has passed, but I'm still living in the on the 17th day. Am I right? So we look at it as that way. The Lord said 1,000 days with the Lord, year, 1,000 years is one day, and 1 day is 1,000 years. So we are living in the, since the gospel, we're living in the second day according to God as He looks at time. Time don't matter anything to God. He just did that, gave us that for an illustration. But we are living in that last day of time before Jesus comes back. The last of the last days we're living in. We're still in the gospel last days, but we're still in the gospel day. But we are entering, I believe, closer every day to the coming of the Lord when He comes. Am I making any sense? Nod your heads one way or the other. If you're totally confused, please nod your head the other way. All right. You understand we're living in the last day, the end of the last day. Now, this know also that in the last days, what kind of days? Perilous times shall come. Perilous has the idea of being reduced in strength, of being difficult days, of being dangerous days. Now, we're talking about the believer here, and we're talking about the world around us. It's talking about being furious days for the believer, being fierce days for the believer, perilous, perilous times. We are living in the last day, and perilous times are upon the believer. I'm doing a little bit of thought and a little bit of research. Today, Christianity is the most hated and the most persecuted religion on the planet. Christianity. God's people that hold the truth of the Word of God and believe the truth and the doctrine of the Word of God are even more persecuted. You say, well, I'm not, listen, there is people out there that would take our lives in a minute if they thought they could get by with it, or if they had the opportunity, and if God, God allowed them to do, because people hate believers. I've got a lot of friends, and I've got friends that are lost friends, not close friends, but they're friendly acquaintances that are lost people, and they're not that way, but there are those out there that would destroy every believer in Christ if given the opportunity, because they, these ISIS and terrorists and Al Qaeda and all these people, they have vowed that we are the enemy, and that we, should not even be able to live because of our faith and belief in the Lord Jesus Christ. Preacher, that's terrible. No, it's what it's been since the beginning of the gospel. Christianity has been despised and been hated by the world and by the devil, because it is the way to eternal life, salvation by grace through faith. So this know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. These things that I'm reading to you about in just a minute were the same in Paul's day, and yet as we go farther, it seems like it's getting worse, and of course it is. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. And that can mean, that has a great, broad meaning. Lovers of them own selves. I see people that they love themselves so much. I mean, you just tell they're so proud and puffed up and have such a love for themselves, men and women both, that you can see it on them. They love them on themselves. I know individuals that if you walk next to them, they want to, you know, just step aside a little bit because they're much better than you are. They love themselves. They're much better than you are. Y'all ever been around people like that? There's people I get around, I speak to, and they, speaking to you, I'm better than you are. And I guarantee you, when it comes time to drink water, they drink water. When it comes time to put their clothes on, they do it the same way I do. And I guarantee they're no better than me, friend. Matter of fact, if you look at it on the grand scheme of things, I've got it better. I'm not better than they are, but I've got it better than they do because I've got a home in heaven. Amen. But we're living in last days when men are lovers of their own selves, covetous. If I could just have just what somebody else has got. If I could just have what they've got, how well off would I be? A whole lot of the time, friend, what they've got is what you don't need. Amen. If they're God's people, they need it because God supplied them with it. And if I need it, God will supply me with it. Amen. I believe that. I hold no animosity whatsoever to a child of God that has great things of this earth, great money, great wealth. If they're a born-again believer using it for the glory of God, I've got no animosity one bit for that. Now, I'm not jealous. God said he would supply my needs according to his riches in glory. God said he would supply your needs according to his riches in glory. And as long as their needs are getting supplied, it shouldn't matter what anybody else has. Amen. Amen. But there's people that look at other people, boy, if I just had that. They're covetous. Oh, I want that so bad. I know people go head over heels in debt just to keep up with whoever else they're trying to keep up with. I give that up a long time ago. All that does is cause you more trouble because you'll get it and not know what to do with it. I've said many times, if I ever coveted to want to have anything, there's a couple of things in life. One of them I ain't give up on yet, the other I have. One of them's a boat, a pontoon boat or a bass boat. But now God showed me, when would you use it? When would you use it if you had it? It would be a great temptation to me to take off weekends once in a while and drive that boat down to the lake and get on it and just have a good time when I know I ought to be in the house of God. I'd done that once or twice, and it didn't pay off well at all. I thought one of the greatest things I could do, and I've told you this story, but it brings home a good point, so I'll tell you again. I wanted things that I did not have any reason having. While I should have been in church, there were things going on Sunday with another fella that he kept after me to do, and I said, well, I ain't been in church in a while anyway. I'll just go do this. What I didn't know I was saying to myself was, you're backslid anyway. Just go ahead and enjoy being backslid. That's what I was telling me. So me decided, I've always wanted to learn to water ski. Do y'all remember this story? Raise your hand if you don't. All right, just a few of you. Then the rest of you, hang on. I wanted to go water skiing. And I thought that would be great fun. He said, come on, let's go water skiing. So about 10 o'clock, we drove down to the lake. We lived down in South Carolina. It's close to Lake Kiwi. And we drove out there about an hour's driving. Backed the boat off in the water and got on the boat. Now, I'm not a stranger to boats. That's not. But I was a stranger to water skis. So I got in the water. He said, here's what you're doing. He showed me and off he went. And, okay. I got in the water, put the skis on. I thought, this is going to be easy. Well, after drowning about in water and swallowing 2 or 3 gallons of Lake Kiwi water, I thought, this is not easy at all. All in the back of my mind, you ain't got no business being here. You ought to be in church. The bells are ringing right now. You ought to be in the house of God. But guess what I was? I was covetous of something that I didn't even need or want. And so about the 18th trip,
I finally decided to quit fighting it. And when I did, I got up. I thought, boy, I'm doing good now. About that time, I hit a wave. And head over heels, I went. I didn't have no sense to turn the rope loose, so I was like a lure underwater waiting for the big one to come and grab me. Somebody said, turn the rope loose, turn the rope loose. I thought, stop the boat, stop the boat. I finally turned, and when I turned that rope loose, I reckon there was enough torque on me to come flying out of the water. And when I did, my skis came off. And the last thing I remember was seeing one come and hit me right between the eyes. And the moment that happened, I thought, you ought to be in church. Now, why did I? Listen, covetousness will get you in trouble. Now, it's probably very useless to tell you this, but I've yet since to be back on a pair of water skis, which I would try again, but guess when it would not be? It would not be on Sunday. I don't covet it that bad. Covetousness is what destroys a lot of God's people in these last days is having, and people will do anything. They'll take on a second job to have something somebody else got. You know, they'll do all kinds of things, go deep into debt to have something somebody else got when they don't need it. God said that He would supply my needs according to His riches and glory. I quit praying for a boat. I don't need it. Now, if I ever get to the place where I quit public work, which I hope to, and have a little extra time, maybe God will let me have a boat that I can go Thursday or Friday or something and go down the lake and go fishing, because that's all I want to do. Believe me, I'm not going to get one for a water ski. But listen to me. If God did that and God allowed me to have it, you know what I'd name my boat? Visitation. So when someone called and asked for the preacher, they could tell without lying that he's out on visitation. Does that sound like a plan? Hey, but I'm not coveting none of that stuff because I know what it will do. It will get me in trouble. It will get you in trouble. So we have learned to understand that God said He'd supply our needs, and if we let Him supply our needs, sometimes God will supply our wants along with it. But we just pray God supply our needs. We're not to covet. In the last days of time, what's going in the world along with in Christianity in churches even, people, churches covet what other churches have got. There's no need to be like that church. We take what God gives us, do with what God gives us to do, and we rely on God to use us and to bless us and to help us and understand God's got here what He wants here, and if He wants to bless it and grow it, God will do it. Amen. I'm just going to preach to you the Word of God and let God do what He wants. Amen. Covetous. I'm going to have to be through before I get started. Boasters. Boasting has no place unless you're boasting about how good God's been to you. But I know people that boast of their wealth. They boast of their worldly gains. Even God's people boast of what. You know, and I'm proud to tell you, if God does something for me, I'm proud to tell you God's done it for me. Amen. Nothing wrong with that if God's getting the glory. Back to the boat again. If God gave me a boat of any sort, I would have to say, look what the Lord gave me. You know why? Because He could trust me with it then. He could trust me with it not to have. If somebody gives me a boat, oh my goodness. But anyway, if that happened, that means that I could say, look what the Lord gave me. I ain't spending a dime on one. God have to give it to me. The other thing that I have not given up on yet, and I don't covet, but I'd really like to have, is a motorcycle. All of them shaking your head, no, preacher, you don't need a motorcycle. I don't, or God already gave it to me. But if he ever allows me to have one, amen, I'll have it and say, look what the Lord gave me. But I wouldn't dare have one if God didn't allow it to take place easily. You know, I ain't going to go in debt for a motorcycle. I don't covet it, just something I'd like to have. Now, if I coveted a motorcycle, I'd go down to the bank and I'd borrow me $10,000. I'd go over to the Harley place and I'd buy me a Harley. But I don't want it that bad. I've got other things that have greater priorities than that. And I'm not going to put myself in that shape and then get out there and get killed on it because it wasn't what God wanted. Y'all, some of you smiling, some of you shaking your head. I'm just trying to tell you that we're living in the last days, and these are some things that will get God's people in trouble if we don't allow God to direct their lives. Proud, boasters, blasphemers, taking God, talking about God, disrespecting the house of God and the things of God, disrespecting God's people, blasphemers, disobedient to parents. I go on about these things because I see them every day. You see them every day. If you're in school, you understand that they come to school the way they are because they're at the house the way they are. Amen. If they're ruly at the house, they'll pretty much be ruly at school. If they're unruly at the house and can't do nothing with them, you take them off school. Depend on them to do something for you. Their hands are tied. They can't help you. Disobedient to parents. Unthankful. Unholy. How much unthankfulness is there in the world today? A lot is right. How many times do you go somewhere and see somebody getting something in there? You know, the world is lit. Our country is living on a handout today, but do you think they're thankful for it? No, they're not grateful for that. They're just afraid it's all going to be taken away from them. I hope it does. Go to work. If you're going to live, go to work. Proud to have you in the country, but if you're going to live here, you're going to live on your own dime and not mine. Go to work. But people are so unthankful. All they look for is the next handout. Let me tell you something. We're living in the most unthankful days that I know about. It's hard. You can't even get people to say thank you. You can't even get people to say excuse me anymore. And I get annoyed at that because people are unthankful. They're ungrateful. But you know why? We're living in the last of the last days. We're living in the days of the coming of the Lord, and soon He'll come, I believe, quickly. And when He does, we'll be out of the whole mess. Won't have to worry about none of it. Won't have to be disturbed about anything. Amen. But guess what? The world will go on as long as it can, being unthankful. The world has become this, and I'm going to have to quit pretty quick, unholy. Have you ever lived in such a world that is so blasphemous and so unholy that they care not how they use the name of God, how they use the name of Jesus, how they use Him in a byword, how they use Him in three letters. I see sometimes quote unquote Christians use OMG. That's just blasphemy. That is just cursing. That's taking the name of the Lord in vain. We shouldn't do that. But that is all because people are living unholy lives. And when God's people begin to live unholy lives, friend, we know we're living in the day of apostasy when there's a falling away of the people of God. See, there's coming a day, and in these last days, when God's going to separate the wheat from the tares. The wheat are those that are born again in the grace of God. The tares are what come up with the wheat, and God has to separate them out because they're not wheat. They're tares. They're weeds. Unthankful. Unholy. And then he goes on to say, they're without natural affection. Now, I can open up a can of worms, which you all know what it is, and it's been opened up so many times, it's wriggling everywhere, but I've never seen a day when there was such unnatural affection in this world. Unnatural. And you, I mean, go on and on about the unnatural affection of people of this world. It's just unnatural. I read a story the other day about a, this is perverted as all get out, but it's a mother in love, I don't know where I seen that at, in love with her son. I love my daughters, I love my son, but it ain't in that way, but she did. Loved her, that's unnatural. Unnatural affection. The whole sodomy thing, to use a Bible word, is unnatural affection. That ain't natural. But that's the day that you're living in. It was in Paul's day in the last days. It's in our day in the last of the last days. And it's not going to get any better till the Lord comes. Unnatural affection. Truce breakers, and a man's word's not worth anything anymore. Tell somebody you do it, do it. Tell somebody you're going to try to do it. Amen, that's your way out, but you still try to do it. But we're living in a day of truce breakers where man's word, nation's word, country's word, the leader's word does not matter anymore. A day of false accusers. A day of incontinence where people cannot control themselves in any fashion. Whatever the wind's carrying that day, they're on that wind and they're going the direction the winds are blowing them. Whatever affection it is, or whatever sin they're wanting to, they have no control over themselves. None whatsoever. Because they're not led by the Holy Spirit of God. They're led by the devil. So they're incontinent. They have no control over themselves. They're fierce. Living in days where people are despisers of those that are good. Despisers of those that are good. Listen, if you live godly in Christ Jesus, the Bible says you shall suffer persecution. We'll get there in a minute, maybe. But we're living in that day of time when people are heady, high-minded, lover of pleasures, more than lovers of God. They're false accusers, the incontinent, they're fierce, despisers of those that are good. All of these things. And friend, if you determine in your heart that you are going to live godly and listen by the Word of God and by the claim of the Scripture today, you and I should live godly in Christ Jesus. If you're a believer, it is your duty as a believer to live godly. Lord, help me. And that's what I say, God, help me to live godly because I am in Christ Jesus. If you're in Christ Jesus, according to Scripture, you and I should live godly. What is that, preacher? Read the Word of God. It'll tell you everything you need to do. It's your handbook. It's your guidebook. Traitors, heady, high-minded, lover of pleasure more than lovers of God. This world is seeking for something that will give them pleasure, and that pleasure usually comes in the form of sin, and it does give pleasure, but it don't last long. It's only for a season. Having a form of godliness. Now, there's churches everywhere, big churches, little churches, that have a form of godliness, but they deny the power of God. I tell you what, I'd rather be at Gabriel's Creek this morning than any church I know of, because we don't only have the form of godliness, but we have godliness. The Lord helps us. God's with us. The Spirit of God moves in this place. But there's churches all over that there wouldn't be enough power in there to bust a peanut hole this morning. There's a lot of action, there's a lot of words, there's a lot of noise, but the power of God is not real in some places. But they've denied the power of God,
and went to something to draw the crowd. For of these sort, the Bible says, from such turn away. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lust. In other words, those that have not the power of God are easily led about by every wind of doctrine. And will follow just anything. I've known some folks in my, you know, in my ministry, I've known some folks that seem to be doing good, and then all of a sudden something new would come out and they'd go chase that for a while. They'd wind up back in where they ought to be, but they'd carried away by every wind of doctrine, chase after anything, because they were not settled and did not know the doctrine and the teachings of the Word of God. They were carried about everywhere. And that's what this is leading to. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of truth. Men and society are more head smart than they've ever been before, yet dumber than a box of rocks when it comes to things called common sense. Just ain't got none. It ain't there. That's the first amen I've got today. Thank you, Brother Matthew. But listen, people are smart in the brain, but when it comes to common sense, they're just not any. It's not out there. But they're ever learning, but never know the truth. People have gotten so smart that they believe anything except the Bible when it comes to things of creation. And I'll get to that later, maybe. But people are, you know, they are very intelligent intellectually, but again, they have no common sense. But they're ever learning, but never coming to the truth. Friend, I'm telling you, I have some education. I'm not, you know, totally dumb. Totally uneducated, but I'd rather have no education and know God and the Scripture and understand it than to have all the knowledge that this world has to offer, but never come into the knowledge of the truth of the things of God. I'm richer because I know the knowledge of the truth of God than anything else. I'm rich in that. And friend, that's what's important. Learn all you can and can all you learn. I mean, learn it, put it away, let God use it when he needs to, but ever learning and never coming to the knowledge of the truth. And I'm going to finish right here because I'm just getting started. Now, as Janes and Jambres, if that's what I'm saying right, withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds reprobate concerning the faith. Now, who was Janes and Jambres? Anybody know? I said Wednesday night. Those magicians that followed Moses around when Moses was leading the children of Israel and was before Pharaoh, and Pharaoh saying no, and God putting a plague upon them, the magicians were those that would come and imitate that plague. As they withstood Moses, or they stood against Moses, Moses had the power of God. These two had the power of the devil. And believe me, friend, that is a power. But as they withstood Moses, so do all of these that has just been spoken of here do resist the truth. These withstood Moses, and what were they doing? They were standing against the truth that Moses had. They were standing against what he was standing for. And they withstood him, so do these also resist the truth. There are people today, you can tell them the truth. No, that is not the truth. Why? Because all they have is head knowledge, ever learning but never coming to the truth. All they have is head knowledge, and stand and tell you, you're a liar. But you know you've got the truth. They're the ones that's living in darkness. Ever learning, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. So do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. Now, friend, you and I know all that we know because of this Word of God. I never did get to my text, but I will. As we study the Word of God, and whatever I've told you this morning is not contrary to the Scripture. We just read it to you.
And if you want to gain knowledge this year, gain it out of the Word of God. Now, you got to learn other things, I know. But please, I'm begging you, this year, as a body of believers, gain all the knowledge you can of the Word of God. You're going to need it. I'm going to need it in these last of the last days that we're living in. What does the Bible tell me? That simply, that you and I all understand, if you're saved by the grace of God, you know you're saved because you came to the knowledge of truth. You came to the knowledge of truth that you're a sinner. You're a sinner lost without God, without hope. You came to the knowledge of truth that if you didn't get saved, you were dying and going to hell without God, without hope. You came to that knowledge. It might have, if you were saved at a young age, you might not have understood all that at the time, but you do now. You understood that the only way you could escape hell was to believe the gospel that the preacher was preaching or that some Sunday school was telling you, or you believed that Jesus died on the cross, that he rose again, born of a virgin, rose again, ascended to the right hand of the Father. You believed that by faith because that's the gospel. That's how you got saved. If you should be here today and you don't know the Lord, the only thing you can do is understand you're a sinner in need of a Savior. Understand that Jesus was born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, died on the cross of Calvary. Why? To pay for your sins so you don't have to die and go to hell. That's why he died. And then on the third day, he slapped the devil in the head, knocked him on the head, and rose victorious over death, hell, and the grave. There he sits today at the right hand. All you have to do is believe that by faith and say, Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Will you save me? And guess what? Jesus said that all those that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So friend, today you've heard the truth. You've heard the gospel. You've heard the truth. You've heard the truth of the scriptures. What will we do with it this year? The Bible in perilous times. Father, we thank you for the Word of God. Lord, I feel with all my heart we've done exactly what you wanted us to today, even though we didn't do what I thought we was going to. God, you're still in control. God, I thank you. Lord, please help us these days, these last days. Lord, to center our thoughts upon the Word of God and upon the things of God. God, that we might grow in knowledge of the Word of God. Lord, that we might hide it in our hearts that God, in these last days, should it ever come to time when they try to destroy the Word of God, and which they're already doing, but try to take it from us, we'll have it hid in our heart. There be someone here that's lost to that, God. Touch them with the spirit of conviction today that it might come to know thee. In Jesus' name. While every head's bowed, no one looking around. I wonder if there's a child of God here today and say, Preacher, I want to know more about the Word of God, and I'm determined